Hey, good morning. It's good to be here with you all. I love the Resolve, love Dwayne and Amy. We got to see them last night. Went over to their place for some carne asada tacos and just had a great time with them and their family. Like Ryan said, Dwayne and I have been friends for a while, probably 10 to 11 years now. We actually went to college together at Point Loma Nazarene here in San Diego. And didn't know each other then, but got connected when we both started churches, Acts 29 churches here in the Southwest. So it's good to actually be here. I've been here one time before, and that's when you were in your old building. It was years and years ago, and this place is better. So nice work on that. We are going to be wrapping up Galatians chapter 5, if you want to turn there with me. They gave me two verses to tackle, the last two verses of Galatians 5, and I'm worried that that I won't get done in time. So that's the preacher's disease. They give you two verses, and you go, ooh, two verses in 45 minutes? I don't know. So it'll be an hour. So what I love about this section is that it's a little bit of a break from the like law gospel stuff that Galatians is, and it's just kind of a constant, like if you've been here at the Resolve through this Galatians series, you're kind of at this point going like, we get it, law, gospel, you're kind of sick of it at this point. So the spirit little piece here in Galatians 5, the end of the chapter, is kind of a blessed reprieve in some ways. But in reality, if we can see it, if I do my job right, I think we can see it as really just one of the key implications of that kind of law-gospel tension. It's kind of how do we walk out that once we've understood the gospel in light of the law, the role of the law as it introduces us to the gospel, kind of then what, right? So this section in verse 16 started by Paul saying, but I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. And now it's going to wrap up in verse 25 saying, if we live by the Spirit, let us also walk by the Spirit. So the last two guys, I listened to the sermons online, did a fantastic job setting up, really unpacking this series, and so or this little section. So I'm happy and humbled to be able to kind of wrap it up and really try to answer the question. Like Paul starts by going, okay, let's walk by the Spirit so we don't gratify the desires of the flesh. He ends by going, hey, if we live by the Spirit, let's walk by the Spirit. And what I want to talk about today is like, where are we walking to? Okay, where is the Spirit leading us and where are we going? Okay, so let's pray quickly and get into Galatians 5, 25. Jesus, this is your word. We stand beneath it. Lord, we rejoice in the power of it. And God, pray that you would open it up to us, that you are open our eyes to see, open our ears to hear, open our hearts to receive your word. I pray that my words would be your words and that you would speak through me this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Verse 25. If we live by the Spirit, let us also walk by the Spirit. Now, here's how a two-verse passage becomes a 45-minute message. I got to stop on the word if, okay? So if, point one, if, right? So let's really be clear about this. This is a section designed specifically, speaking specifically to Christians. And Paul sets up this kind of if-then, right? Like, if you walk by the Spirit, then there are some implications for that. But here's the deal. This transcends just Christianity. The logic that Paul lays out here of the if-then applies to everyone. So I don't care if you're here and you're an agnostic, an atheist, a Muslim, a Buddhist, a surfer. I don't care what you're doing, what you believe, what you're into. There has to be an if-then. So Christians get killed for being hypocrites, right? Like that's one of the easy tropes that we see paraded out in the media that we experience in our day-to-day lives talking to friends, coworkers, schoolmates, that Christians are such hypocrites and that's why, I can't believe it, or I don't like it, or whatever. And here's the deal. It's totally true, right? Like nobody in their right mind would try to deny that Christians can be hypocritical and certainly could be characterized as hypocrites. But my goodness, so are you. Like you're super good at it too. We're all really good at being hypocrites. And hypocrisy is simply that the active disconnect between the if and the then. So all hypocrisy is going, hey, I believe this, I think this, I am this, but then a knowing disconnect between what we say we believe and know and what we actually do. Okay, and here's a key piece. There's a difference between hypocrisy and failure. Huge difference between hypocrisy and failure. Hypocrisy is, I believe this and have no intention of living it out. Hypocrisy is, I believe this, this is who I am, and I'm gonna talk real big in the media, or I'm gonna wear the t-shirts and the wristbands and whatever else you do, and yet nothing in your life. You have no intention, no interest, no even understanding of really what that might mean. So whatever it is, I'm a liberal, I'm a conservative, I'm a Democrat, it doesn't matter. Let's go, okay, is there a connection or at least an intention and connection between who you say you are and what you say you do? Is there a thoughtfulness to that? Which is really different than just sucking at it, right? Like, which is what most Christians actually do and actually are, which is going, I'm a Christian, but man, I am terrible at it. I follow Jesus really badly. I'm trying to walk with Jesus, but I just, every time, I'm terrible at it. And here's the deal. Jesus, like, predicted that. That was part of the plan from the beginning. And this is really what separates Christianity from any other faith or philosophy, any other ideology or any other identity. What separates Christianity is an expectation for failure and an answer, a solution to it. Jesus isn't surprised by your failure. He died for it. See, the real challenge with atheism and agnosticism and then whatever other kind of vagueness spirituality that anyone else might ascribe to is there's no plan for failure. There's no solution for failure. And see, what that does, it promotes fakeness. It promotes hiding, and it really discourages vulnerability. It discourages honesty about who you are and what you're doing because there's no plan. It's either I'm good at this and I'm consistent with this, or I'm just terrible at it. And we take that on as identity rather than going, no, I'm a Christian and I'm terrible at it. And Jesus knew I was going to be terrible at it, and so he died for me. He sent his Spirit for me so that there might be an answer, there might be a solution to my failure. Okay, so Paul starts with the if. He goes, let's just establish here what we are claiming to be, who we are claiming to be, to say if we walk by the Spirit or if we live by the Spirit, then there are some implications for that. And so I would just challenge you here today who are not a Christian, I know you're here, just to assess your personal connection between if and then in your life. No matter what your thing is, no matter what your identity is, just a connection between if and then. Okay? So Paul goes on. If we live by the Spirit. Now, again, stopping there. This is the foundation of it all. And I don't mean the foundation of the sermon, though it is, not the foundation of the chapter, though it is. I mean the foundation of Christianity. I mean, the very foundation of Christianity is that we are not independent people. We are not independent, self-actualized, kind of independent, unneeding people. That the very foundation, like the very first step into Christian faith is the step of I need. The step of without the Spirit, without the gospel, without Christ's death and resurrection, I'm dead. That my very life is dependent on something outside of myself. That is literally step one. That is the most fundamental piece of the Christian faith. Our life comes from the outside. And Paul establishes this right in this key verse. And we're gonna come back to this in a minute, because this really is the foundation of what we want to talk about. Paul says, if we live by the Spirit, and here's the then, let us also walk by the Spirit, okay? This is a very simple idea, and so I'm going to use my simplest illustration, right? We've all seen a relay race, Right? Raise your hand if you've never seen a relay race. Great. So in a relay race, someone starts with the baton, right? And they're here, and then they start moving. And then there's this, the kind of the, what seems like the hardest part of the relay race is when the next guy already or girl starts moving and the other guy's moving. And there's like that awkward, like, hey, what, how fast are we going here? You know, like, you know, and there's the final handoff, right? So the guy starts running like this. And then there's the handoff. And then what does the second guy do? Don't overthink this. Just keeps going, right? Like in the same direction. So the first guy's running this way, hands, second guy grabs, and then just keeps going. What would happen if the guy got the baton and went like this? That was a question. They'd lose, okay? So like, this is hard. It's a rainy morning. I'll give you some grace. But they would lose, right? That's not the point. That's not the direction. You get the baton and you continue to go in the same direction. That's what Paul's saying. Listen, if you live by the Spirit, if you are animated by the Spirit, if what gives you identity and what gives you life and what makes you you in the most fundamental sense is the Spirit, then shouldn't you just kind of keep walking in the direction of the Spirit? This is like the key to Christian discipleship. Jesus puts the baton in your hand. I know this is theologically, we'll get there. But Jesus puts the baton in your hand in terms of your life and discipleship, and you go, okay, well, I got to walk the way Jesus was walking. And which way is the Spirit leading? The Spirit is leading in the direction Jesus was already walking. So it's like, Jesus is behind me, Spirit's ahead of me. I'm getting it from Jesus, and I'm following the Spirit. I can't do it any simpler than that. So if you're like, what? Where's the baton? I can't help you, okay? So that's my simplest illustration. Okay, so it makes no sense then, it's Paul's logic, it makes no sense that we would take the baton and walk in the other direction. Or it makes no sense, as I see, I've been in ministry 15 years or so, this is what I see more often, not so much take the baton and be like, oh, whatever, is take the baton and go, oh, sweet, I got the baton. Guys, the baton, right? And we just kind of stop. Paul goes, well, that doesn't make sense either. You've been given life. You've been given the baton. The Spirit has indwelt you. The gospel has changed you. You are now free. Keep going. Be launched. So I was at James Coffee Shop. Is that what it's called? In Little Italy this morning. I texted Ryan Buss. I was like, what's the hipsterest place in town? And that's where I ended up. So I was sitting there, and they have TVs, and they had The Great Escape up. You guys seen that movie, Great Escape? It's fantastic. It's so good. They're escaping from, it's about an escape. And so I'm watching this, and I had this thought. It's like, what Paul is trying to talk about here, what he's trying to illustrate for us is this idea. You're in prison, somebody slips the key under the door, and you pick up the key and go, oh, I got the key, but I'm going to stay here because the cell isn't so bad. I know it's cramped, but the rent is good. And I've got my little hole here to do, and my mat is good, and you know, I don't have to clean much, you know. And we've got the key. We've got the key to our freedom. And we look at that door. Maybe we even put it in the door, turn it just to test it, close the door back up, peek out. What's freedom look like? Too scary. Paul goes, if you have been given life by the Spirit, if you've been animated by the Spirit, then walk by the Spirit. Take hold of that gift of life that you've been given and live it out. So the only way this doesn't make sense, The only way we would go, well, I don't know. I don't really understand. I don't know that I want to walk out into freedom. I've got the key, but it's safe in here. It's warm in here. I don't know if I want to go out there. The only way we could possibly look at the cell of our prison and prefer it to freedom is if we fundamentally misunderstand the whole system. It's as if we think about our salvation like we can be in a prison, that we are technically free, but that there's no upside to getting out. That this 5x5 that we're in is pretty good, actually. And now I just have the freedom. Now I've been empowered to do whatever I need to do whatever I want to do. But actually, what's out there isn't a lot better than what's in here. And so I'm content with the life that I have in prison, and I have no reason to go out. So Paul, in verses 19 through 21, says this. He says, now the works of the flesh, or what prison's like, okay? The works of the flesh are evident. Sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these. And so for some of us, if we're honest, we would never do that in church, but if we were honest, we look at that list and go like, yeah, but like, is all of that bad? But like the orgies. Some of you are like, wait, sorcery? There's a no sorcery rule? Does that count LARPing? For some, we look at that list and it doesn't sound all bad. Like Paul's doing kind of a crappy job of convincing us to get out of the prison when he goes, hey, you've been given the key to not have to do that stuff anymore. And you're going like, but I kind of like it. Is it really that bad? See, it's a fundamental misunderstanding of the whole system, of the whole paradigm. Some of us think that God in heaven before the beginning of time looked down and before he gave us the law, looked down on earth and goes, okay, what do they like to do? Okay, they like to do that. They like to do that. They do that a lot. And okay, that's bad then. That's bad. They seem to be smiling a lot while doing that. Bad. And like compiling this list of the thou shalt nots based kind of on what we actually like to do and what we might be getting just too much joy out of, right? Just too pleasurable. That's not the deal at all. The story is, and you've heard this here at The Resolve so many times, I'm sure, creation, fall, redemption, restoration, that God created for the fullness of our experience, the fullness of our satisfaction, the fullness of our joy, the fullness of relationship with God, with ourselves, with each other, and with his creation, that was God's intention. And what we see now is a twisted, distorted, lesser version of that. And so when God hands us the key, he hands us our freedom into redemption with the hope of returning back to that perfection that he created us for. So it makes absolutely no sense for us to have the key to our freedom, but stay in our prison cell. It means we're thinking about what we've received in salvation completely wrong. It's as if we thought, okay, I like this stuff and I want to be a Christian so that I can do this stuff and be forgiven for it. You think about it contractually almost, like, okay, I will do these things so that I can do these things without consequences. That ain't it. Over and over and over, Jesus said, hey, what you think is good is actually not. What you think is healthy is actually hurting you. What you think is up is actually down. What you think is weak is actually strong. Like, you've missed the whole thing. The way I intended for it to be, Genesis 1 and 2, it lasted not long, 2 chapters. In chapter 3, then it got flipped upside down and went, oh yeah, Satan goes, oh yeah, all that stuff you thought was great, it's actually terrible. And what Jesus is giving us by the Spirit, what the Spirit is leading us into, is a greater and greater understanding that what he intended for us, the freedom that he intended for us, is actually more satisfying, more life-giving, more joy-giving, more everything than the little cell that we've made for us, that we've grown so content with. Okay, so that's Paul's logic. If you profess faith that God has saved you from the lie that the world, the flesh, is actually a good life instead of the destruction that it actually is, then it makes no sense for you to keep walking in that destruction. Okay, so that's the first verse. Verse 26. He then says, let us not become conceited, provoking one another, envying one another. Now, this seems a little like a non sequitur, right? Wait, what are you doing? In fact, some commentators have connected verse 26 to chapter 6 and said, well, actually, the French guy that put all the verses and everything, he kind of messed that up. That should have been chapter 6, verse 1, because it really connects better with the second half than the first half. Why would Paul be talking about living by the Spirit and then all of a sudden shift gears and go, let us not become conceited, provoking one another, envying one another? And I would agree that this verse does connect really well to the next several verses as Paul kind of finishes up Galatians talking about the community of faith and the church there in Galatia and how they can interact with one another. But it is absolutely not disconnected from the previous section. It is, in fact, the perfect transition from heart, spirit leading out of ourselves to the community around us, to the people around us. St. Augustine argued that pride, conceit, synonyms, that pride is the foundation for all sin because it puts a person's focus on himself or herself instead of God and other people. That actually pride is underneath every other sin, that it is the root cause. And that pride is essentially a complete self-orientation. Pride, when it's manifesting in ourselves, causes us to ask the question, how does this affect me? How does this reflect on me? What does this say about me? So you process everything, filter everything around you through the lens of me. Someone else gets a promotion. Oh man, what's that mean for me? Why didn't I get that promotion? Maybe you even worked together and you wanted that promotion. Maybe you see someone's relationship that they have that you don't have, and you go, well, how does that reflect on me? So personal story. I have a friend who is going to get a second master's degree, and I thought to myself, oh man, I'm still 3 classes away from my first. I got to catch up. She can't be ahead of me, you know. Like, how does that reflect on me? Am I uneducated now? Am I undereducated? You know, I see her great progress in life only insofar as how does it reflect on me and talk about me and what will other people think of me? How does this redefine who I am and how people look at me and see? And everything is just me, me, me. So everybody, everything, every interaction that you have, everything going on around you, you process through the lens of me. So because pride is at the root of all other sin, because it rejects the centrality and the authority of God and makes you the center, and makes you the authority, every other sin flows from that, including verses 19 through 21 that we just read. So here, go back real quick, because I want you to see this connection that Paul's making. Every one of these sins in verses 19 through 21 has at root me, right? Read it. Works of the flesh are evident. Sexual immorality, about what I want. Impurity, I'm going to do what I want to do. Sensuality, my feelings, what I'm feeling right now is what I want to do. Idolatry, I get to choose what's most important, not God. Sorcery, I don't know. Spells to get your own way, I don't know. Enmity, strife, right? You're fighting for things. You're fighting for yourself. Jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, because I'm going to do whatever I want to do. Orgies, because I don't care about the value of the other person. I'm going to use them for their bodies. They exist to serve my physical desires. I don't have to love them. I don't have to care about them. I don't even have to value them as a fellow human being. They are a combination of pieces that I want to experience. It's about me. It's about what I want. It's about what I want right now. And your consequences are yours to deal with. Pride is at the root of every single one of these things. Everyone and everything exists to serve you, to give you what you want. You are all that matters. Tim Keller wrote a great little booklet about humility called The Power of Self-Forgetfulness. That's such a beautiful title. Because the opposite of pride isn't like some fake deference of like, oh no, I suck. Well, I mean, you do, but like in moderation, right? Like in context. So the opposite of pride, which is self-orientation, it isn't you being terrible. It's you not thinking about you. It's you understanding that God is at the center of the universe, not you at the center of the universe. And if God is at the center of the universe, then what God wants and what God wills and what God desires is what you desire most, ought to desire most, and that is to serve and love others. God told us what is at the center of his desire, at the center of his will. When Jesus said the greatest commandment in the law is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself. There is nothing more pride destroying than to follow the greatest commandments. To love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself, because you are not part of that equation except insofar as you serve and love and give yourself away. So why does Paul go from, if we live by the Spirit, let us also walk in step with the Spirit, walk by the Spirit, to let us not become conceited? Because the thing that stands in the way of us walking by the Spirit is our pride. That the Spirit goes, you know, Jesus hands us the baton, the Spirit goes this way, and we go, nah, I got the baton, I'm going my way. And the Spirit's going, no, 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 this way, this way, this way, into life, into freedom, into satisfaction, into joy, into peace, into love. Come with me, walk by me, walk in step with me. And we go, no, it's my baton, it's my life, I do what I want. Paul goes, that's pride. Pride that fights against the will of God in our lives. It's pride that causes us to resist the leadership of the Spirit in our lives. And this manifests itself, according to Paul, in two different ways. One, provoking one another. Two, envying one another. Really, really practical applications. These two sides of the same coin. It's the ways in which our pride flares up when something good or something better happens to people around us. We've all been there. We all know that feeling. So I just want you to stop for just a minute and remember that feeling. It starts somewhere like in here, right? When you see something happen to somebody, you see somebody, you go, I want that. I want to be that. I want to hear that. And it starts right around here where you go, why can't I? Why don't I? It's not fair. I have four children, a 7-year-old girl, a 4-year-old boy, a 2-year-old girl, and a 6-month-old girl. And my oldest, 7, has just discovered those three little words, it's not fair. And so I sat her down and said, hey, sweetheart, remember last week when I took daddy on a, or daddy took you on a date? Yeah. Did any of the other kids go with you? No. Was that fair? Well, no. Hey, you know how like you get to chew gum? We have like a 4-year-old rule. They can't chew gum until they're 4. You know, you get to chew gum and none of the other kids can. Yeah. Is that fair? No. So my thing for her now is you don't want fair. Right? It's amazing a parent's ability to turn something like that into a threat. Oh, you want fair? Oh, I'll give you fair. Right? It's amazing how 40-year-olds are the same as 7-year-olds. That's not fair. Why does he get that? Why does she get that? How come I didn't? I want gum. I mean, you're just substituting gum for promotion, gum for car, house, wife, husband, younger version, I don't know, whatever it is you want. You're saying the same things. That thing in you hasn't changed. It's got different focus and different desire, but it's the same pride. Because I deserve, I want. And Paul goes, we deal with it differently. Some of us provoke, right? We compete, we fight, we belittle, we gossip. Why would they get that? Are you serious? Have you seen him at work? Have you seen his work habits? What's he produced? Are you serious? That guy, he's a moron. Some of us, we envy, dream, fantasize, long for, we internalize, we undercut. One of us likes to take the other down a notch. The others of us like to bring ourselves up a notch, so we kind of tell little lies to make ourselves sound better. Paul's going, it's just pride. It's conceit. The Spirit's leading you that direction. And what's in you is looking around everybody else and go, hey, is everybody else going this direction? Because I don't want to go this direction. If somebody else is going another direction, that direction might be better. Or just me going in this direction makes them think they're better than me because they're not better than me. I'm just trying to follow the Spirit. Hey, I'm following the Spirit better than you are. And we just get all the, right? We're constantly, no matter where we're going, no matter what we're doing, we're constantly kind of looking around. What are they doing? What's going on there? What's going on here? Are they better? Do they think they're better? Are they actually better? Do I think they're better? Like, it's just this constant battle, this constant mess inside of our hearts as pride just is messing with us. No matter what step we take, pride pulls us in 4 different directions. Always, every time. Over and over and over and over. Both of these things are products of pride because they don't allow you to be happy for, to be proud of, or to simply enjoy the good that others are experiencing. It doesn't allow us to enjoy the good that God is doing in people's lives. Think about that. Think about that for a minute. That in that moment when you see someone get something great and you envy, Or that thing starts here and it starts to well up into a belittling comment. It starts to well up into a fantasy. It starts to well up into something. Think about what you're doing. God, as the scriptures tell us, every good and perfect gift comes from the Lord. Everything comes from above. God has bestowed on them. God has cared for them. God has loved them in some way. God has given them a gift. God has demonstrated his grace towards them. And our response is, not at something, it's not about them. Think about that. It's something God is doing to them or God is doing for them. And so our grumble here is about why couldn't I get up underneath that? Like, God, why couldn't you drop that on me? Why was it? And so our grumble is God, is to God. It's about God. Did you ever think about the fact that if God gives something to somebody else, it means he didn't want you to have it? He didn't want you to have it. And I don't know why. Maybe he couldn't trust you. Maybe he's got something else. Maybe it's better. Maybe it's worse. Maybe it's not about you. I mean, that's where I get in this thing is I struggle with pride like crazy. And so I see somebody else get something and I go, well, why couldn't I? Or why wouldn't, oh, if I had only, but they're not. And then I feel like God occasionally drops this hammer on my forehead and goes, I wasn't thinking about you at all, actually. Why would them have anything to do with you? Why are you putting yourself into that situation? It's got nothing to do with you. That was me and him. You got your own stuff over here. Remember when I did that? Remember when I gave you this? Remember when you don't deserve that? Remember that wife I gave you? You think you deserved her? We just put ourselves into that situation, into their lives, which reveals a fundamental lack of trust in the goodness of God, the wisdom of God. So Paul goes, man, if we are going to walk by the Spirit, if we've been given life by the Spirit, we've been animated by the Spirit, we are dead without the Spirit, then we ought to walk in step with the Spirit, follow the Spirit. And what will prevent us from doing that is our pride, which is going to pull us this way and pull us that way and pull us this way and make us question and make us think that everything's about you. It's not. It's about God. It's about the Spirit. So what do we do? When this starts to happen, we start to feel that thing move. One, remember the truth about God. Remember the truth about God. Remember who God is and what God has done. Remember that God is almighty, that God is sovereign, that God is good, that God is wise. Remind yourself who God is and what God does. God bestows gifts. God gives grace. God is merciful. God provides. It's God who's doing those things. Remember the truth about God. And then once you've started to kind of, I don't know, for me, when I feel that thing happening and I can remember, like, God is good. God is the giver of good gifts. God is sovereign. God is powerful. This thing starts to go, and then I can start to be a little more logical and I ask myself, why? Why do I care? That's number two. Ask yourself why. Why do I care? What is that in me? What am I? Because usually this feeling, I mean, everybody's going to have different things that provoke that, right? My neighbor gets a boat and I go, ah, you got to clean that sucker. I don't care. But for you, maybe your neighbor gets a boat and you go, oh man, my little paddle boat, it's not good enough or whatever. Like, everybody's got different things and it's tied to idolatry. It's tied to what you care about the most. So that's what you ask yourself, like, why do I care? What's going on in my heart there? What do I value that I'm not getting? What is it? What is it for me in this moment? And then praise God in his infinite wisdom that he did what he did for a reason, and rejoice with the person who got it. Praise God, acknowledging you're smarter than me, you're better than me, you're more sovereign than me, you're more good than I am. And rejoice with the person that received the blessing of God to go, man, isn't that great? God is good. So glad he gave you that. So glad you got that gift. Enjoy that. Rejoice with them. Lastly, I've been reading this book for a while now in kind of my devotional time. It's called Humility by a man named Andrew Murray. If you want to receive, what would I call it, a spiritual kick in the groin, I recommend this book. I want to read to you from the very first chapter. It says, when God created the universe, it was with the objective of making those he created partakers of his perfection and blessedness, thus showing forth the glory of his love and wisdom and power. God desired to reveal himself in and through his creatures by communicating to them as much of his own goodness and glory as they were capable of receiving. But this communication was not meant to give created beings something that they could possess in themselves, having full charge and access apart from him. So for our message, God's giving us the baton, giving us his glory, giving us his life, but not so that it becomes ours. Like, I got this baton. This is my baton, and I'm in charge of the baton. I got this life, and it's my life, and I can do with it what I will. Not at all. It says, rather, God, as the ever-living, ever-present, ever-acting one, who upholds all things by the word of his power, and in whom all things exist, meant that the relationship of his creatures to himself would be one of unceasing, absolute dependence. As truly as God by his power once created all things, so by that same power must God every moment maintain all things. Here's his point. God's desire in creation, the first chapter of that story, God's desire in creation was to bestow upon us so that we might experience all the as much goodness and as much of the glory of God as we could possibly stand. But not like a gift, not like a, hey, I'm giving you this thing and now go enjoy it, but as a welcome into an ongoing codependence. We are dependent on him for it at all times. He's not dependent on us. But he's giving us the keys to a relationship that we have been given an opportunity to drink from the source. But at no point have we gotten our fill of the source and can then walk away with our stuff. That God offers to us an ongoing relationship that gives us a continual taste of his goodness and glory and grace. That we are dependent beings, not just before we take the baton, not just before we believe the gospel, but almost especially once we have believed the gospel. Because now our eyes have been opened to the possibilities, and every step along the way, because of the anger and the battle that Satan brings into our lives, because of the flesh, because of the world, because of all of it, we walk every step in dependence by the Spirit. These two verses are the most fundamental piece of our Christian faith. That we cannot get the gospel if we don't first understand that we are needy, dependent beings. And that is so hard to do. Because nobody wants to admit that. Nobody wants to admit that. Our pride fights that. Our culture that was created by the pride of many people fights against that. Nobody wants to admit that they are weak and needy. Everyone wants to show that they've got it together, that they're in charge, and they can handle it. So why does Paul sum up this section by going, don't fall into conceit? Because it's the very thing that pulls us away from God and stops the flow. Because once we think we are independent and not needy, we step away from God. We step away from prayer. We step away from the glory of God and try to make it and handle it on our own. Because we become convinced we are no longer needy people, if we ever were. We've got it. And the Spirit keeps walking and leading us in this direction, and we're off doing our own thing, going this way and that way and this way and that way, because we got it. Because we got it. And here's the deal. No, none of us believe that. I mean, we're not going to admit it, but none of us believe we've got it. Nothing in our life suggests that we've got it. Nothing that we're doing can really consistently make us think we got this thing handled. You're doing a great job of hiding it. Sometimes it boils out and people see it. And you cover it up. But I'm just telling you, this is step one. And it's step one not just of a long, it's step one of every day. It's step one of every moment. I am in need and I need you. I am in need and I have to reach out for something strong. And the only thing that can bear the weight of your neediness without getting tired, without failing, without making promises it can't keep, is God, is your Savior Jesus Christ, is the Spirit whom he sent to lead you. Let's pray.